Imagine you're walking in the forest and you encounter an object. What questions come to your mind? First of all, what is this? Is this a stick? Obviously, it's a stick. Secondly, what can I do with it? If you are a child like this little fellow, poking somebody with it may sound like a great idea. Or if you're older, you can probably use the stick as a walking aid. Find some more sticks, and maybe you can use them to build a shelter. Or you can use them to keep warm on cold winter nights. The stick is an example of an entity, and the many uses of it are called affordances. This video is about Schema.org actions, and you can think of them as entities plus affordances. What's so exciting about actions? I think that actions can enable some of the experiences I only read about in science fiction books growing up. But let's start at the beginning. Hi, I'm Jarek Wilkiewicz. If you watched the previous two videos in this series, you know that my DJ buddy Sean and I built a system to make the data from our music store machine readable and available in the knowledge graph. We used schema.org and JSON-LD so that when a user says, OK, Google, and asks to listen to a music artist we carry, our mobile application will be ready to fulfill user's request. Sean and I published the information about the artist we carry in our store. We used JSON-LD markup and embedded it in artist web pages on our site. We associated our mobile music app with the artists we carry so that our app could be triggered by the OK Google voice command. Remember my story about the stick? As I told you earlier, the many useful and not so useful things about that can be done with it are called affordances. An affordance is a quality of an object or an environment which allows an individual to perform an action. What does this have to do with schema.org actions? Let me explain. If you take a look at this JSON-LD markup, you will notice that the potential action property identifies a listen action affordance. This means that the music artist from our store can be listened to using our mobile app. Let's revisit the simple architecture diagram from our first video. The JSON-LD markup from our store site is processed by a crawler and then saved in our small knowledge graph running in an open source graph database called Cayley. The crawler parses the markup from our site and transforms it into triples. Triples are a data representation well suited for graphs. Once we have the triples, we can load them into Cayley. As you can see in this visualization, green nodes represent the potential action. Much like other structured data about our music store entities, we have loaded the potential action triples into Cayley. We have also loaded a music dataset from Freebase. Now Cayley can answer handy questions such as, how can I listen to Nerdcore? As you can see, the query produces an Android app as the result. The app can be invoked to play the music we want. To show you how this all works, we'll use our Android Actions simulator and our sample music app. Let's try to listen to Nerdcore. With the simulator, we can issue the query for the genre. The full query expression sent to Cayley is similar to the one I showed you earlier. This should trigger our sample music app. Oops, or maybe not. Why isn't this working? Let's look at the Android manifest of our sample music app. Oh, we forgot to include the intent filter. We may need to fix that. Media play from search handling was missing from our manifest. Now we can try again. Sure enough, the music starts playing. All right, so far, we've covered how a mobile app can be triggered in our response to a voice command, and I showed you the JSON-LD markup which enables this. What about the web? Schema.org actions allows us to specify web actions as well. For example, similarly to the mobile app, we can indicate that the artist from our store can be listened to on the web. Note that the HTTP link identifies the URL where the user can listen to the artist. Besides the listen action, what other types of affordances can we specify using schema.org? A lot of them. Not all of them apply to all entities, though. For example, listen action may not work very well with a stick. OK, let's look at another affordance called the search action. To illustrate how the search action works, we will use our web simulator to help us invoke actions. Let's fire it up. All right, let's point the simulator at our music site. As you can tell, the simulator detected we have a search action available. How did it do that? It's quite simple. As you may have guessed by now, we use schema.org actions markup on the main page of our store. Here's what the markup looks like. Let's highlight a few things. The potential action target is an HTTP URL template. Remember that in the mobile example, we were using an Android deep link. The URL template is defined by RFC 6570. And while that's a very awesome spec, we won't get into the details here. Suffice it to say that the query parameter is properly substituted by the client, or in our case, the simulator. Let's now invoke the search action. As expected, we found dual core. Since the simulator also detected the listen action in the JSON-LD response, we can invoke it. This takes us to our jiatic-andshawnmusic.com site, where user can listen to dual core. The target URL the simulator uses is defined in the JSON-LD response. Now we can hit the play button and enjoy. All right, let's think about the search use case for a second. We use schema.org actions to describe the search endpoint. The simulator sent a GET request to the URL defined by our markup with a query expression. Note that we have associated a RESTful API affordance with an entity serialized as a JSON-LD document. This is an example of a hypermedia API. The hypermedia API topic is quite fascinating in itself, but we won't get into it today. If you would like to learn more about hypermedia APIs, click the link on your screen. As you can tell by now, schema.org action spec is quite expressive, and I have barely scratched the surface in this video. I am very excited about the potential of schema.org actions. I think it's a step towards making the dream I shared with you in the first video a reality. Okay, what do we do next? Let's learn more and clone the repository that we have shared to try it out. You can also get more information from developers.google.com/schemas. Last but not least, if you find this technology interesting, please let me know. I would love to hear from you. Thanks and have a great day.